Good morning, everyone. Today we are going to start gynec oncology, and in June we will be dealing with two chapters. The gynec oncology part one would be concerned with general information about the cancers, and part two would be concerned about the management of the gynecological cancer in general, which would include surgery, radiotherapy, chemotherapy, adjuvant therapy, neoadjuvant therapy, palliative therapy, immunotherapy, and those modalities of treatment, which would be not specific to a particular type of cancer but would be a general principles of all type of cancers. And today's class would also be a general overview of all types of cancers, and we would be taking specific cancers, basically ovarian, uterine, and cervical, in the subsequent lectures from July onwards. So to start with, this is the ribbons which are being shown are basically for screening and prevention programs which are being held all over the world and in various months to protect against or to make the public aware of the various types of cancer. Of all the gynecological cancers, the main cancers are ovarian, uterine or endometrial cancer, cervical cancer, vulvar and vaginal cancers, and we deal with fallopian tube cancer along with the ovarian cancer. So what is cancer? Cancer is derived from a Latin word for crab. Now, just as a crab in its natural habitat is fast, resilient, and it springs into action and moves into very multiple directions, so as are the properties of cancer cells, which are very irregularly shaped, and because like a crab they grab on and don't let go, and they are the new growths which have the ability to invade the surrounding tissues and to move from the primary tumor to distant locations of the body, that is to metastasize. So it the word cancer was derived from this word crab. On 4th of February each year, we celebrate World Cancer Day. So the cancer is a term used for diseases in which the abnormal cells divide without control and are able to invade the other tissues. This uncontrolled proliferation of cells also has a de-differentiation. That is, the cells do not differentiate as they should, and there is a loss of function. Of course, they have an invasive local property, and then they spread via blood or lymph to other parts of the body. So these are the basis of cancer. When we see the cancer burden, see on this chart, the total cancer burden of last 15 years, they run in millions. And if we see male cancers, female cancers, total cancers, they have been steadily increasing, seeing to the number of incident cases, the predicted cases, till the year of 2020, they are still increasing. So it is a major burden. All types of cancers combined together are major burden to the community. Coming to the cancer statistics, see the death rate. It is nearly quarter of the death rate is being taken up by the cancer patients. It is second to heart attack or heart diseases. And of the cancer statistics, many of the deaths worldwide are because of cancer. Coming to Indian scenario, seeing to the female population, there is a difference in the developed and developing countries. See the F, G, H and I columns. So this is the female breast cancer list, which is in developed countries like USA. And in our country, the basic burden is by this purple line, that is the cervix and the ovary, the uterine, breast. So these are the differences in developed and developing countries. In developed countries, it is basically the breast and the uterine cancer, and in underdeveloped countries, basically the cervix, and then comes the ovarian and breast and uterine. This picture shows that it is geographically distributed. There are variations, but it is found all over different types of cancer, depending upon the socio-demographic status, depending upon various habits which the people have. The various varieties of cancer are seen, both in male and females. 2018 data shows that still breast cancer and cervical cancer take the major brunt of all the type of cancers. And among the males, it is the lung cancer and the oral cancer. So, the cancers which are arising from the organs of the female reproductive tract, we would term as gynecological cancers. And we would be dealing subsequently into ovarian, endometrial or uterine cancer, then cervical cancer, vulvar cancer and vaginal cancer. The cervical cancer is the number one killer of the women worldwide. See the data. It is approximately 570,000 cases worldwide and so many deaths worldwide just because of cervical cancer. Although it is a cancer which is viewed through the speculum if the patient is in lithotomy position, and you can always see the cervix and diagnose the cancer, still it is a number one killer worldwide. This is how you report and see the cervix, what is like a normal cervix, this is low grade cervix, this is high grade lesion, this is cancer lesion. But with the advent of many screening procedures, one of them being PAP, the incidence of detection has increased, but still it is a major cause of death. We would be expanding on each of them when we deal with a separate cancer. Ovarian cancer, this forms from the tissue of the ovary and is an overlooked disease and is also called as a silent killer because it shows less of the symptoms as a menstrual bleeding and therefore it is not diagnosed early. Coming to endometrial cancer or uterine cancer, is the malignancy of the uterine lining. See this picture of endometrial carcinoma showing increased endometrial thickness and increased vascularity, and the picture of the same uterus as gross specimen showing endometrial carcinoma of the cavity. The vaginal cancer is the malignant tissue growth arising anywhere in the vagina, and vulval growth or cancer are mostly like these type of cauliflower growths which arise from the vulva. So cancer is a disease where cells grow out of control and invade, erode and destroy the normal tissue. And still the research is going on, and we are not yet, after so many years, have been able to control, and still a major cause of death. So whenever the normal body cells grow, they divide, they function and they die in an orderly fashion. There is a cell cycle. But when cancer cells are there, they are different. Because they don't die, they just continue to grow and they continue to divide, and that too in a disorderly fashion. So that is cancer. The medical term for tumor or cancer is neoplasm, which means autonomous growth or uncoordinated cell proliferation of body tissue. It means a new growth, and the process of cell proliferation is called as a neoplasia, and the branch of medicine is called as oncology. So normal cell, it can be genetic change that is inherited, or it can be environmental change that is non-inherited, make certain changes in this normal cells so that it becomes a cancer cell. And see the doubling time. It doubles so fast that it becomes a malignant. And whatever is the time we get in this is the time where we can cure. If we catch the cells in this stage, we can, by screening methods, by other modalities of detection and timely treatment, we can save the lives of many at this stage. So coming to various terms which we will be using across when we will be dealing with the individual cancers, just to highlight those terms, neoplasm is abnormal new growth of cells. They grow rapidly, more rapidly than the normal cells, continue to grow if they are not treated, and as they grow, the neoplasm can impinge upon and damage the adjacent structures. A tumor is a commonly used term, but it is non-specific term. The word tumor simply means a mass. In general, that mass can be benign, can be malignant. And when it is malignant, then it is cancerous growth. So there are differences between benign and malignant, and the cancer is another word for malignant. So what are the differences? Basic differences you all know, but just to brush up, the rate of growth in a malignant tumor is more rapid than in benign, which is slower. The nature of growth is that it invades the surrounding tissue in malignant, but in benign it expands in the same tissue, as we see in fibroid. Spread is metastasis via the blood and lymphatic and local spread. Benign doesn't spread. And cell differentiation, if we go, this is poorly differentiated, but benign tumors have nearly the same normal cells. What are precancerous conditions? If they are, we have seen that endometrial EIN, CIN, these are called as precancerous cells. That is, the cells are abnormal and they can, in due course of time, develop into cancer. They have mild changes which may disappear with or without treatment. Some precancerous cells pass on genetic changes and gradually become more and more abnormal as they divide until they turn into cancer. It takes a long time for precancerous condition to develop into cancers. We'll be seeing that in from CIN to major cancer of stage 1, it takes about 8 to 10 years. And this is the time where we can detect and screen in the precancerous condition so as to make it a reversible condition. The term hyperplasia means abnormal cells are dividing and increasing in number, so they are faster than normal. The cells look normal under microscope, but there are more cells than normal. Atypia means that the cells are slightly abnormal. They are atypical and may be caused by some healing, inflammation, but can be precancerous also. What is metaplasia? It means that there is a change of type of cells that are normally found in this type. Particular area of the body, there is a different cells are present in that area of the body. The cells look normal, but they aren't the type of cells that are normally found in that tissue. Again, the term dysplasia is misleading, but means that cells are abnormal. There are more cells. The cells are growing faster than normal. They are not arranged like normal, and also it is a precancerous condition. Carcinoma in situ, you can take it as a more severe form of precancerous chain, and it has a high risk of developing into cancer. So taking one example, this is a normal epithelial tissue. It has a yellow line or a basal layer. Then there are a basal cells, which are usually the dividing cells, which form the upper layers, and then there is a upper layer. Now what happens in dysplasia? Now the cells are, we talked about that the cells are abnormal, more, growing faster than normal, not arranged like normal. So these are the features of dysplasia, the red ones. When it reaches the carcinoma in situ, see the change. It has reached up to the layer and all of the cells have been replaced by the cancer cells. But there is no invasion of the basal layer. And then the fourth variety, that is the malignant cells, where the basal cells, the basal layer has been breached and the cells have invaded the local tissue. Once they have invaded the local tissue, they find their way into the lymphatic or into the bloodstream, and then they travel through the lymphatics and the bloodstream to adhere to the capillary wall, and then they reach a different organ. Suppose in this picture it has reached the liver, and then they escape through this vessel and they form metastasis in a different organ, that is in the liver. So starting from the uterus, lining of the uterus, they have reached the distant organ of liver. So those are the events of metastasis. What are the types of cancer? Basically, all are not carcinomas. The carcinoma is a term which is used for epithelial lesion, that is skin or tissues or which linings which cover the internal organs, and it can be epithelial cell carcinoma or glandular cell carcinoma, that is adenocarcinoma. When it comes to basal cells, then it is basal cell carcinoma. When it is squamous cells, it is squamous cell carcinoma. So it is the lining of the either cavities or skin that would form a carcinoma. The deeper structures like bone, cartilage, fat and muscle, blood vessels, connective tissue, supportive tissue, when these are involved, they are named as sarcomas, like leiomyosarcomas we have seen. Then what are the fluid cancers, that is the blood forming tissue cancers? They are leukemias. And when they are of the immune system, they are lymphomas and myelomas. There are cancers of the central nervous system, and germ cells we will see as in the ovary and testis, they are the germ cell tumors. So ovarian cancers, we will be discussing germ cell tumors. And still non-differentiated ones are blastomas, when they are still not differentiated into the sperm and the ovary and they are of the embryonic tissues, then they become a blastomas. So the million-dollar question remains, what causes cancer? Now you can divide that every cell has a life cycle. It grows, it functions, it divides and then dies. This is a cell. And when these controlling factors, which are the genes, are damaged, the balance between this normal cell cycle is lost. The cancer cells are caused by DNA damage and out of control cell growth. The factors known to damage DNA therefore would increase cancer. So apart from the genetic role in cancer, the mutations, mutations can also be because of environmental reasons, because of certain microbes, because of lifestyle and diet causes. So there can be inherited factors and non-inherited factors. So this is the human cell, which has differentiated into lining, bone cells, the germ cells, ovum and sperm, then blood cells, RBC, WBC, then neuron cells. This is the, and all of them have differentiated from a single cell. So these are the embryonic cells. And every cell undergoes a cycle of the growth. And this is one of the examples of cervical changes, where they undergo changes. This is the normal picture of cells. Then some changes occur, early changes, which we call as precancerous changes or cervical intraepithelial neoplasia 1. The changes increase the nucleus size, the shape of the cell, the size of the cells, the involvement into the layers. They all change and then they are over towards the higher side and then they become CIN2. And more of the changes where all of the layers are involved and all of the cells show typical changes of a tumor, they become CIN3. So these are the changes which are occurring in each of the cells. What is causing these changes? Apart from the genetic, there are various factors and they have been tabulated, like tobacco, diet and obesity. Diet and obesity in gynecological cancer has a great role, because obesity is a cause of increase in estrogen, and therefore most of the cancers which are estrogen based or hormone based are increased where there is a obesity. Infection, when you see to infection, the viruses which cause infection like cervical cancer, the human papilloma virus, infections are the cause of cervical cancer. Then there are reasons like radiation, stress, lack of physical activity, environmental pollutants, and the list goes long, which are the risk factors of cancer. So physical agents we have seen like radiations, which can be x-rays, gamma rays, can be sunlight rays of skin cancers, and these affect various type of skin, lung, breast, osteosarcomas, etc. There can be biological agents like we will see be seeing in the cervical cancer, where the viral agents are the cause. There can be other fungal and bacterial agents of various cancers of the body. There can be chemical agents like in industries, which may be the cause of cancer. And of course, genetic factor remains like various genetic genes, which we'll be talking about basically in breast and ovarian cancer. And dietary and habits like tobacco, alcohol, and high fat diet are the causes. Taking mutation as a cause, the gene mutations or genetic basis of the cancer is in itself a very vast topic. And the genes which are concerned with ovarian cancers or gynecological cancers are one of the genes called BRCA1 and BRCA2. And they are also increased in breast cancers, which can inhibit the body's ability to safeguard and repair the DNA. These are genetically inherited and they cause a familial basis of cancer. When you see the molecular basis of the cancer, suppose the mutation is to occur in one of the somatic cells, so there can be inherited mutation, which are the genetic factors, and then there can be acquired, which we saw that they can be chemicals, radiation, various viruses. And what do they do to the somatic cells? They first cause activation of the growth promoting oncogenesis. Then they alter the apoptosis, that is the natural cell death. And then they inactivate the certain tumor suppressor genes which are present. So tumor suppressor genes are inactivated, the cell death is affected, and then promoter genes take place. And the result is expression of an altered gene product and loss of the regulatory power of gene products. The clonal expansion occurs, additional mutations occur, and then becomes a malignant neoplasm. So these genes, mutation and cancer in nearly every cell in the body has all the genes which we are born with. An abnormal change is called mutation. It can affect how it functions, and the inherited gene mutation can be present at the level of egg and sperm, while the acquired or somatic mutation is acquired sometime later. The acquired mutations are much more common than inherited, and most of the cancers can be inherited. So this is one of the pictures of a National Cancer Institute, which shows that it can occur at the DNA transcription level, it can occur at RNA translation level, and at the protein formation level. So it can occur at all the stages. And the types of genetic mutations in cancer can be of various varieties. The genetic basis of cancer itself is a very long topic. The hereditary gynecological cancer syndromes, which is called as HGCS, are the inherited ones that are drastically increase a chance of being diagnosed with certain gynecological cancers. Most common genetic bases are BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations that cause breast and ovarian cancer and a 50% chance of passing it to the next generation. Also, you would hear the name of Lynch syndrome, which is another notably hereditary gynecological cancer syndrome and often associated with other non-gynecological characteristics of the syndrome and often seen along with the stomach, small intestine and colorectal cancers. Environmental causes still form a major bulk. They are radiations, they are various sunlight, other causes which can cause ultraviolet radiations, air pollutants, wood dust, industrial cancers, these are the environmental causes. of the microbes as a cause, we would be dealing with HPV in detail when we see cervical cancer. Lifestyle choices, eating poor diet, inactivity, obesity is a major cause in gynecological cancer. Tobacco and alcohol use can be associated with other types of cancer. So the data says that every 6 minutes a woman is diagnosed with a gynec cancer. These are the major risk factors and these are the prevention and screening tips. So family history, we discussed BRCA1 and BRCA2 gene mutations are genetically inherited, mostly important for gynecological cancer, and therefore genetic testing of the first degree relatives, mother, daughter, sister and female relative which has ovarian cancer, you should get a genetic testing done before the age of 45. Early cancers are because of genetics. Obesity, a major cause in gynecological cancer because it leads to increased androgen and then estrogen production, and this leads to a greater risk particularly of endometrial cancer, and the prevention and screening would be a healthy diet and exercise, a healthy lifestyle. Most of the gynecological cancer occur in a menopausal or postmenopausal age group apart from genetic, which occur at a little early age. And therefore, a regular doctor visit and any abnormal vaginal bleeding should be taken seriously in this age group and should be treated. And HPV is a sexually transmitted disease that causes nearly all types of cervical cancer and some of the vaginal and vulvar cancer as well. And there are various screening tests for those detection, and there is also a vaccine for that. The type of cancers we discussed, that it could be from carcinoma to sarcoma to myeloma, leukemia, lymphoma, all types of cancer can be there. And they can occur at all age groups, they can occur at anywhere in the body, they can basically be classified as solid and liquid. The solid means those with a breast, lung, prostate example, and liquid means most of the blood cancers. We discussed that the word carcinoma is used for epithelial tissues, and carcinoma, which includes adenocarcinoma, 80-90% of them, and then sarcomas are those which are involved with the connective tissue like bones, cartilage, fat, blood vessels and muscles, and leiomyosarcoma is one of the examples. The major parts of the body affected, almost all parts. It's starting from the throat cancer to esophagus to lung. In females, the breast cancer is important, then the GI cancer, then the urinary tract cancer, and then we come to genital tract cancer and then the skin cancer. So all body cancers are present. General symptoms of the more than 100 types of cancer, every cancer maybe have some individual symptoms, and every individual is also unique and also depending upon the size and the location of the cancer. But in general, all cancer patients seems to have a poor appetite, there is a significant weight loss, there is excessive sweating or night sweats, there is severe pain, there may be neurological symptoms, there may be blood and vomiting, there may be bowel symptoms if it is colon, there may be fever in case of blood, and therefore of course abnormal uterine bleeding in case of gynecological cancer. So flow chart of gynecological symptoms when the patient comes to you. So 5 or 6 main symptoms are there of the 5 or 6 carcinomas. Coming to pain, the pain could be pelvic or pressure pain. And it is almost always present in all types of, be it cervical, ovarian, uterine, vaginal or vulva cancer. There would be some type of pressure or pelvic fullness to all of them. Abnormal vaginal bleeding or discharge, the two things, the abnormal vaginal discharge in postmenopausal or abnormal vaginal bleeding in perimenopausal is basically a feature of uterine cancer, and the discharge is basically a feature of cervical, and ovarian cancers can sometimes produce. But most of the ovarian cancers have a bloating sensation or bowel or bladder changes and abdominal or back pain. So those are the features of ovarian. And itching and burning of the vulva and changes in the vulva skin and color, rashes, sores and warts are basically of the vulva cancer. So when whenever there is an abnormal vaginal bleeding or discharge, then think of all types of cancer, be it cervical, ovarian, uterine or vaginal, except in cases of vulvar cancer. When there is a feeling of fullness too quickly or eating difficulty, mostly it is an ovarian cancer. When there is a pelvic pressure pain, it is mostly an ovarian cancer. Maybe when it is large enough, it can cause pressure symptoms, that is uterine cancer can cause. More frequent need to urinate or there is a constipation is also a feature of ovarian cancer. But if it is a large vaginal cancer, it can also press on the urinary tract or onto the bowel. The sense of bloating and abdominal and back pain is typically a feature of ovarian cancer. And of the vulvar cancer, you would get itching, burning, pain, tenderness, sores, rashes, warts. This would be a feature of vulvar cancer. So in general, those would be the symptoms when we deal with individually each cancer. So ovarian cancer, how do you diagnose? There is a spotting or bleeding between menstrual cycles. Mostly it is a postmenopausal woman or perimenopausal woman complaining of intermenstrual bleeding. She also complains of a swollen or bloated abdomen, loss of appetite, feeling full quickly. There is a lot of gas and indigestion and nausea. Then there is a frequent urination, and then there can be pelvic pain and pressure. So these symptoms are above the pelvic pain or pelvic pressure. So these are more frequently seen in ovarian cancer. Coming to endometrial cancer, most of the time the lady is in 60s and 70s and they are postmenopausal bleeding or irregular bleeding between cycles, the heavier or longer menstrual, so all the features of abnormal uterine bleeding, and there can be pain and mass in the pelvic area. Coming to vulvar cancer, there is a constant itch and there are changes in the skin color of the external genitals. There can be ulcers, there can be masses, there can be irregular bleeding between menstrual cycles because of that erosion of the ulcers or masses. So that is vulvar cancer. Vaginal cancer again complains of postmenopausal bleeding, and when it is pressing, that there could be painful intercourse or urination or bleeding after intercourse, constipation, and a vaginal mass can be felt. And coming to the last most important cervical cancer, any vaginal bleeding that is not related to the menstrual bleeder, there is postmenopausal bleeding or painful postcoital bleeding, then or foul smelling vaginal discharge because of the cervical lesion, these should be taken as cervical cancer in mind. So this is nutshell of symptoms: pelvic pain, pressure, change in the bowel bladder habits, feeling quickly full, trouble in eating, back pain, upset stomach, fatigue, itching, burning, menstrual symptoms, and painful intercourse. So moving further, how would you differentiate cancer? The cancer has a cancer grading and cancer staging. Now what is cancer grading? It is based on how the cancer cells look. How do they look compared to normal healthy cells? And this is the terminology used, is the differentiation. Whether it is well differentiated, it is not differentiated, depending upon the size, shape and arrangement of the cells, and helps to predict how fast the cancer will grow and divide, how likely it would spread, the areas of cell death or necrosis. Hence, you could plan a treatment or prognosis. It is usually described using a number from 1, 2, 3, 4. The higher the number, the more different are the cancer cells or more faster they are growing, that is high grade. And this is the usually a pathological diagnosis of a tissue sample under a microscope. So grade X means that the grade cannot be assessed. And when you go from grade 1, which is well-differentiated glands and mitotic figures are moderately numerous, then grade 2, where the cells are moderately differentiated, there has been a change. And grade 3, where they are all poorly differentiated, you cannot see all the glandular structures. So this is HPE gradient. The lower the number means that is a lower grade cancer. Different parts of a single tumor can have different grades of cancer, but the tumor is usually graded on that slide as the highest grade, which is seen anywhere on the slide on that within the tumor. The low grade cancers have cells that are abnormal. Lot of them may look normal. They are also arranged more like a normal cells. They grow slowly, they spread slowly, they are well differentiated, are low grade. In contrast to it, the high grade cancers look different from normals, arrange differently, grow more quickly and more likely to spread. Differentiation refers to how the developed cancers are and how well they are organized in the tissue or organ. Grade and differentiation are basically the same, but grading is a standardized way of measuring differentiation. Coming to the clinical part, that is staging of cancer. To know how much the cancer is there in the body, where it is, how far it has spread, what you do is staging. This would help you to know what treatment plan has to be made. Cancer, we have seen, that can spread within organ to start with. Then it would go by lymph to surrounding lymph nodes. Then it would go metastasize to distant places, and then you do different tests to find out where it has spread. So normally you stage them from 1 to 4. Stage 1 means usually small, it has spread, it has not spread, it is limited to the organ itself. Higher the number, the larger the tumor, the more the spread. And so you reach stage 4, means that it has spread to distant sites. How you stage or grade is used in the plan of treatment of different types of cancer. So this is one type of classification which is known as TNM classification, where T stands for tumor, N stands for nodes, M stands for metastasis. And then they are subdivided into T1, T2, T3, T4, T0, that is the division. So the depth of invasion, depending upon the depth of invasion, the tumor can be solid, it can be confined, there can be capsular, there can be bone and cartilage, there can be visceral invasion, and the T0 is where there is a no tumor, the organ. Then T1 is see a small tumor, T2 is limited to it but it has enlarged, T3 it is just reaching the margin. Then N0, that is the local nodes, N0 means no nodes. Then N1 means a single node. And then N2 means more than one node. And then metastasis, that is whether it has not metastasized, so there is a zero, it has not reached the lungs, it has not reached the bone, it has not reached the liver. And if it has reached one organ like liver, then it is one. And then it can reach to other organs like bone and lungs as well. So then it would subdivide into T1, T2, T3, T4. You will also divide it into N0, that is, and then you will chart it out as T1, N0, that is, depending upon, then you would do a staging. So N1, N2, N3, N4 would be depending upon the number of nodes. Then you would also see whether there is unilateral, ipsilateral, bilateral, contralateral, that you would be seeing. Then you would see the number, whether it is single, multiple, more than 4, more than 10, there you would see the size of each node, less than 2, more than 3, more than 5, more than 10. Then you would see the mobility, whether it is mobile or attached or fixed, or it is fixed and it is destroying. And then you would chart it out like this, and you would make a stage by T1, N0 or T1, N1 and then T1, N2. So the stage increases likewise depending upon the TNM classification. So basically what we follow in gynecological cancer is a FIGO staging. The TNM classification or FIGO staging, the T denotes the extent of the tumor. That is, whether it is locally or it has reached the full size of the primary organ. N designates whether the cancer has spread to surrounding lymph nodes. And M denotes the distant metastasis. When the spread to nearby lymph nodes cannot be assessed, you write as NX. When there is no spread, you write as N0. When the pelvic nodes are involved in gynecological malignancy, you call as N1. And when periotic, that is it has distant spread, then you call as N2. And most of the lymph node involvement, you will be seeing that in stage 1, there would be 5%. And as you increase the stage 3, as many as 50% of lymph nodes are involved. Coming to the spread, M0, there is no distant spread to other organs. We have seen three main organs, that is the liver, that is the lung, bone and the liver. And then M1 is the spread to other organs, omentum and abdomen. So we have seen this TNM classification. Sometimes there is also added a lower case, A, B, C is used to subdivide the tumor and lymph nodes or metastasis category to make it more specific. For example, T1 it is, then you write a T1A and then you write IS, means carcinoma in situ. For a gynec oncology, we take FIGO staging, which is the International Federation of Gynecologists and Obstetricians staging. We take into consideration, which is similar to TNM staging. FIGO took responsibility of this staging of gynecological cancer way back in 1953. And first FIGO staging has been done by the society in 1961. And since then there has been various revisions many times, and we would be discussing all of them as we go to a particular type of cancer. Then these stagings are basically, all these stagings are basically involving the clinical findings, what you inspect on per speculum examination or per abdomen, then the initial biopsy or surgery or primary surgery or staging procedures, that is histology. Then various imaging modalities like sonography, CT and MRI and PET scan, we would be seeing those also help in staging. And of course the operative findings would help in staging. Other staging systems have also been used in certain types of cancer. For all types of cancers of gynec origin, that is ovarian, endometrial, cervical, vaginal and vulvar, we would all be discussing only FIGO staging, which is based on TNM, which we discuss. But there are, when you study all types of carcinoma, for non-Hodgkin there would be another staging, for Hodgkin there would be some other staging, for leukemia there would be another staging, and multiple myeloma there may be other. So for all gynecological staging we would be following a FIGO system of classification. So basically the stage 0 is carcinoma in situ, that is the early form. It is cancer, it is stage 0, that is it is in situ. Stage 1, it is localized. Stage 2, locally advanced. Stage 3, late locally advanced. And stage 4 is metastasized. Now, having done the grading and staging of the cancer, one of the methods will help in staging of the cancer is the screening. And screening also helps in early detection of cancer and prevention of of many of the cancers going into the severe stages of death. So cervical screening or cervical cancer screening is the most convenient and most popularly can be used. Pap smears have proven to be very effective for cervical cancer screening. For endometrial cancer, there is no effective screening. What we depend on early detection of heavy menstrual bleeding, or you can take an aspirate, or you can do a Pipelis method of endometrial aspiration, or you can do a fractional curettage. Then for the ovarian cancers also, there is no effective screening. But for a method to be cost effective and to be available to mass, ovarian cancers are usually biomarkers based, and therefore it requires sonography, PET scan, MRI, so it becomes a little costly. And silent, these tumors are mostly non-symptomatic, silent, non-specific symptoms, and therefore they are missed. So cervical screening is the most important screening. Of course, we will be dealing with detail when we are talking cervical cancer. But in nutshell, the cervical cancer, because it is easily accessible, where you do a post-speculum examination, you put a Cuscus, you can take out the vaginal discharge, and then you can subject it to histopathological cytological examination, and you can see the type of cells which are there, the different exfoliative cytology tests you can do. The methods which are used are, this is the method where क्या हुआ, क्योंकि मेरे इसमें बंद हुआ, इसलिए मुझे लगा कि कुछ बंद हुआ, ये मेरे इसमें बंद चल रहा था साइड में, वो बंद हुआ। आप करो, कहाँ से बंद हुआ है?
वहाँ से वो एफसीसी एनालिटिक में आ गया, पता नहीं सर कि वो कुछ बच्चे लोग कॉल किया है ना, स्टूडेंट
Welcome and thank you for choosing freeconferencecall.com.
कहाँ से बंद हो गया?
People around the world communicate for free. There are 127 participants in the conference. All participants are muted.
नहीं, ये थोड़ा ऊपर जाना रहेगा मुझे। कितना पहले से था? कितने मिनट पहले आया?
Welcome and
पूछ लेती हूँ।
आप पूछ लीजिए मैम, आ गया वैसे आ गया।
इसको बंद करूँ?
मिनिमाइज करिए,
मिनिमाइज करो।
नहीं नहीं, कैंसिल कैंसिल करिए इसको। हाँ, मिनिमाइज।
एक सेकेंड।
हाँ, आप करिए, देख रहे हो आप।
So we were dealing with cancer staging. We were dealing with cancer staging, and cancer staging means know how much cancer is in your body, where it is, and how far it has spread. This helps them to know what treatments are to be used. It can spread within the organ that it started in, then whether it has gone to nearby lymph nodes or distant sites. To find out the stage, you may have different tests, and you number it 1, 2, 3, 4. The stage 1 cancer usually small, hasn't spread outside, and stage 4 usually means that it has spread to distant sites. We have TNM staging, and T is for tumor, N is for nodes, and M is for metastasis. And when it is T0 means there is no tumor, and T1, T2, T3, you can say, depending upon whether it is solid or hollow organ, you will see whether it is the capsule is involved, whether the adjacent organs are involved, that you will see the type of mobility, you will see the neighboring structure fixity, and then you would see, although it is localized into the tumor, but you would label it as T1, T2, T3 and T4 depending upon the tumor in the primary site. If it has started spreading into the lymph nodes, you would see that whether it has started spreading into the local nodes or it has started spreading in the distant nodes. If it is a local node, suppose this triangle is for the perineum or this side is for the pelvic cavity and this triangle is for the abdominal cavity or the periaortic lymph nodes. So when it is restricted to the pelvic cavity, that is pelvic lymph nodes, it is the stage 1. And when it has restricted, when it has spread distant lymph nodes like periaortic lymph nodes, this triangle, it becomes stage 2 or N2. And there also this can be subdivided whether it has a single node or multiple nodes. Then coming to metastasis, it can be zero metastasis, that is no distant spread to major organs like lung, bone and liver, or it can be single spread to one organ like liver, there is a spread, or it can be three organs, like it can be major organs like lung, liver and bones. Then you see, when you are seeing the lymph nodes, you would see whether the drainage is unilateral or bilateral, whether the distant metastasis has occurred in the lymph node, what are the number of lymph nodes, whether they are 2 to 3, whether they are more than 3, whether they are more than 10. You would see size of each lymph node, whether there is less than 2 cm or more than 3 or more than 5 or more than 10, and whether they are mobile or partial attachment to the muscle, or they are fixed or they are invasive into the tissue. And then you would chart it out into the column wise, whether it is T1 and N0, then it becomes a stage 1, and when there is a T2, that it has a spread locally but there is no lymph node, then it is stage 2. And when it has a stage 1 and stage 2 but there is one lymph node, then it becomes a stage 3. And then there are depending on it, whether there is a stage T3 and N2, then it becomes a stage 4, and then they are further divided into A, B and C for the distant. So this is how you do a staging by the TNM classification. So we discussed that the FIGO staging and TNM staging are taken together in gynec oncology. T denotes the tumor, N denotes the lymph nodes and M denotes the metastasis. And when you cannot find lymph nodes, they cannot be assessed, you write at X. And when there is no spread, you write it at 0. If there is only pelvic lymph nodes, you take it 1. When there is a distant to periaortic lymph nodes, you take it N2. So this classification we would be using individually in cervical, ovarian and in all gynecological cancers. So this forms the basis. And we would be further dividing how the cervical cancer becomes N1, N2 and how the uterine cancer becomes T1, T2. That we will be discussing when we discuss the specific cancers. In general, lymph node involvement in stage 1 is only 5%, and as you progress to the stage 3, more than 50% of lymph nodes are involved. And similarly for the metastasis, there is no spread to distant lymph nodes, and M1 spread to distant lymph nodes or upper abdomen omentum is seen. So we saw this TNM classification, and sometimes you have to subgroup it into A, B, C or subdivide the tumor, lymph nodes or metastasis, and you write a lowercase like T1A or lowercase as IS. It depends on TIS, that is tumor carcinoma in situ. We follow FIGO staging. FIGO stands for International Federation of Gynecological and Obstetricians. It came into force in 1953, and first FIGO staging came in 1961. And FIGO staging requires clinical findings, what you do on a PV or abdominal examination. It requires a biopsy finding, that is histology. It requires an imaging finding, that is either can be sonography, CT, MRI or PET scan, and of course operative findings. And then you stage the cancer. When you stage the cancer, for all gynecological cancer, all the 5 types of gynecological cancer, the type of staging which we will be studying would be FIGO. And this would be based on TNM. But there are other types of staging also for lymphoma, non-Hodgkin's, Hodgkin's, leukemia and multiple myeloma. You would read different type of staging. When you come to stage 0, it is carcinoma in situ. When stage 1, it is localized. Stage 2, it is early localized advanced. Stage 3, late localized advanced. And stage 4, it is metastasized. Of the coming to the screening methods, cervical cancer is the best screening method. Endometrial and ovarian have screening methods but are not as effective. Coming to cervical cancer screening, you just put a Cuscus, you take, it is easily visible, you take a swab, and there are various methods of taking it. So this is the method of taking it by the IR spatula. The IR spatula has this type of shape. The one angle goes into the endocervical canal, one angle goes into the ectocervix, and then use, this is the endo brush, endocervical brush. The other side of IR spatula is used to take it from the lateral vaginal fornix swab, and then you analyze it by the exfoliative cytology, and the red cells you are seeing are the cancer cells, and these are the normal cells. So collection sample techniques, these are the, you can collect it with cotton swab, you can collect it with endocervical brush. This is the wooden spatula, which is of the IR spatula. See the shape of the IR spatula, this goes inside the ectocervix, this goes in the ecto and endocervix. This is for vaginal pool, this is a plastic cannula, and this is the cervical broom or the cytoprep instrument. This concave end is to fits into the cervix, the convex end for vaginal pool, this end is for vaginal pool. This is the cytobrush which you, this is the cytobrush, this type of brush which you insert inside the canal. And what you do is that after fitting it into the cervix, you have a one clockwise direction of 360 degrees, and then you take a specimen which you spread it on the slide, either by the IR spatula or by the endocervical, and then you fix it by the cytofixative solution of which is alcohol. And we will be dealing with a pap smear in detail when we read the screening methods of cervical cancer. And what you see on the cytology are the odd types of cells. The cervical screening methods include via and villi, that is visual inspection of acetic acid and visual inspection of Lugol's iodine. So just as we had a junctional zone in the uterus, we have also have a squamocolumnar junction zone here, which is known as the transformation zone. And this transformation zone can be seen by visual inspection, by colposcopy, by magnification. And when you apply acetic acid on that area, certain cells take it, that is called as visual inspection of acetic acid or acetobite area. And when you put a Lugol's iodine, the cells which take as iodine uptake is a visual inspection of. So you can find out where the biopsy you can take. The colposcope is another magnification system. The instruments look like this, and there are digital colposcopes available, which is just like a smartphone or mobile. And this is the instrument trolley of a colposcope, and this is the similar transformation zone which you see, similar application of acetic acid, but here the magnification is from 10 to 40 times, and therefore you can see the eroded areas, or you can see the acetophyte areas, or you can see coarse mosaic, or you can see the raised lesions, rolled out lesions, rolled out margins. You can put filter, green filters over it so that you can see the abnormal vascular pattern, which could be mosaic pattern, which could be punctate pattern or atypical pattern. So this is the colposcopic findings for screening of cervical cancer. So screening is to be the to detect the disease among the healthy population, and the screening methods should have certain criteria, that is it can be done on a mass of population with less of the resources, with less of the training, and these primary purpose is to reduce the morbidity and mortality of the disease. The benefits would be to early detection of pre-invasive cancer. The limitation would be many of the false negatives and false positive results would be there. So you give assurance to the affected patients and over-treatment of the non-affected patients. Coming to ovarian cancers, you have biochemical markers or tumor markers. There are various tumor markers, CA125, CA19-9, then HCG, BRCA1, BRCA2, alpha fetoprotein, gonadotrophin peptides. Then there can be physical or radiological methods of screening, like you do a PV examination or do a sonography. In case of sonography, in ovarian cancer, you assess the ovarian volume. In endometrial cancer, you assess the endometrial thickness. Then there are biophysical methods which we discussed, pap smears, vulval vaginal smears, colposcopy and aspiration, like these. Cervical cytology is basically exfoliated cells, but we also have liquid-based cytology, we have visual inspection of acetic acid, we have colposcopy and HPV testing. For ovarian cancers, we have biochemical markers. CA125, which is called as carbohydrate antigen or cancer antigen, which is a non-specific antigen found in 80% of epithelial cancer and 50% of the stage 1 cancer, but it is non-specific since it is also found in benign lesions. Value greater than 35 mg per ml is a confirmatory. You have other types of antigens also, 1909, and which are increased in mucinous ovarian tumors and not epithelial tumors. You have CEA, which is increased in mucinous ovarian tumors. You have alpha fetoprotein, which is increased in germ cell tumors. You have human placental alkaline phosphatase, which is increased in germ cell tumors. And of course, in the non-gestational choriocarcinoma, you have HCG. So what is tumor marker? It is a substance which is found in increased amounts in the blood, other body fluids and tissues that suggest the presence of cancer. But the guideline should be never rely on a single test. Order every test from the same lab. Consider half-life of the tumor when interpreting the test, and consider how tumor marker is removed or metabolized. What does a tumor marker do? There is a gene we saw that the gene mutation or amplification occurs when it is at that level, that is a genetic biomarker. When it is an altered gene expression or altered protein or altered metabolite, you have a molecular biomarker or you have a metabolic biomarker. And therefore, you would see the biomarkers in this way. Uses of biomarkers are at all stages. You can assess the risk. You can use it as a screening method. You can differentiate or stratify the patients into it. You can monitor the therapy. You can staging of cancer. You can help in prognosis of cancer and diagnosis of the cancer. So biomarkers can be used at various stages. What are the types of tumor markers or biomarkers? They can be enzymes. They can be hormones. Oncofetal proteins, genetic tumor markers, receptor tumor markers, or tumor associated proteins. Of the importance tumor marker concerned with gynec are the ovarian cancers, CA125, CEA. Then you have breast cancers of CA125, CA and HER2. Then other type of cancers have also various tumor markers. Important tumor markers of this germ cell origin would be alpha fetoprotein and HCG. Apart from tumor markers, you would do immunoassays also, immunohistochemistry also, other techniques like FISH, enzyme assays and HPLC. These tumor markers are important out of the various, these are the most common ones. In case of ovarian cancer, at times, in order to improve sensitivity and specificity, what you do is that you take 4 or 5 tumor markers as a multiple marker blood test. One of them is Oviplex. So what you do is 5 tumor markers you take, CA125, C-reactive protein, you take SAA, and then interleukin, you take 6 and 8 interleukin, and all of them you take as a consolidated Oviplex for early detection of cancer. Genetic screening is genetic hereditary genetic predisposition. We saw that BRCA1 and BRCA2 are associated with ovarian cancer. Coming to ultrasonography is also a method of screening for measurement of ovarian volume being used as a screening method. You do a transvaginal sonography, you see the changes in size and morphology of the ovary, you see the ovarian size. These are the cutoff for premenopausal women, which is 20 cubic centimeter. For postmenopausal women, the ovary size cutoff is 10 cubic centimeter. You also see the ovarian cyst wall. You see how many septa are there in the ovary, and if it is a cystic lesion, you put a color, you see the color flow pattern, and you see the vascular resistance pattern. There is an index called the risk malignancy index, which takes into consideration CA125 as a tumor marker, the menopausal status or the age of the patient, how many years of menopause, and ultrasonography. And then you calculate the risk of malignancy and you give a scoring of each of them. And if the scoring is more than 200, it connotes that a higher risk of malignancy. Coming to laparoscopy as a modality, you can see ovarian malignancy, you can see the size of ovaries, whether it is unilateral or bilateral, how the surface of the ovary looks like, how are the adhesions, whether there is peritoneal lesions, whether there is a situs. So you can see the ovarian structure. So these are the screening methods of cancer. And cancer, we stop here and we would be dealing with the management part in the next lecture. Management of in general cancer, which would take into consideration surgery as a primary modality, then adjuvant radiotherapy, adjuvant chemotherapy, neoadjuvant therapy, immunotherapy, palliative therapy, hormone therapy. These are the in general for all gynecological cancer. This would be your overview of all type of gynecological cancer, and then we will in series take individual cancer. So to end up, the cancer can take away all my physical abilities, but it cannot touch my mind, it cannot touch my heart, and it cannot touch my soul. Thank you.